Good morning. Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church of Waxahachie, Texas. My name's Kevin Tully. I'm pastor here, and we are so pleased that each and every one of you, whether it's your habit to be in your pew each and every week, or whether this is the first time that you have been with us, such an honor to have you. So grateful for your presence and so excited about what it is you and I might experience together in the hour that is to come. Hello to those of you who are worshiping with us online. I know some of you are still members of our church, even though you've moved to another area. Thank you. God bless you. Some of you have begun to worship with us because you found us online and keep coming back. I just want to let you know we care about you. We consider you part of our congregation. So if there's any way that we can help you, assist you in your spiritual journey, please let us know. That goes for each and every one of you as well. One of the easiest ways to help us do that together is if you would be kind enough to fill out one of the connection cards. If we don't really know who you are, no, I understand what it's like to try and fly under the radar for a couple of weeks. I understand that. But if you'd be willing to let us know how we might contact you, email, a phone number where we might text you, we'd be very grateful for that. We're not pushy. We're not going to do any arm twisting. We just want to find out, how can we help you? What are you looking for? And mostly, most of all, to say thank you. This is the second Sunday of the church's season of Advent. Once again today, we will talk about Jesus coming in a special way that maybe you haven't thought about before. We will also welcome everyone to the communion table. We United Methodists do not hold that our baptism or our church membership is any better than any other church's membership or baptism. You don't have to be a United Methodist. You don't have to be a part of this congregation to come and share in the elements of bread and wine, which represent to us the body and blood of Jesus, given for all of us and for all of humanity. So we hope you'll come later on in the service. Until then, let's sort of set the other stuff aside. This has been such a spectacular fall in terms of the foliage that's around town. You and I are healthy enough to be here. There's so much for which to be grateful for. Let us enter into that sort of frame of mind as we prepare to worship together. Thank you again for being here.
That all mortal flesh keep silence and with fear and trembling stand. Ponder nothing earthly minded, for with blessing in his hand, Christ our God to earth descendeth. Our full homage to demand.
As we prepare to light the Advent candle.
False candle of our event release. The candle of hope we light it again as we remember that Christ who was born in Bethlehem will come again to fulfill all God's promises to us.
The second candle of Advent is the candle of love. God's love is a perfect love. It holds nothing back. God in love gives us everything we need to live a life of hope and love. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Jesus shows us God's perfect love. The
This is what love is like. Love is patient, love is kind, and envies no one. Love is never boastful or conceited, rude or selfish. Love is not quick to take offense. It keeps no records of wrongs. It does not gloat over other people's troubles, but rejoices the right, the good, and the true. There is nothing that love cannot face. There is no limit to its faith, to its hope, to its endurance.
Love never ends. We light the candle of love to remind us that Jesus brings us God's love and shows us how to love others. Love is like a light shining in the dark place. As we look at this candle, we celebrate the love we find in Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for the love you give us. As we wait for all the promises to come true, we pray for you for your promises. But help us today and every day to worship you and to hear your word and to do what you're sharing and hope with each other. We ask in the name of the one who was born in Bethlehem. Amen.
Lie dark and low, bright and tall.
Jesus sends us ahead to prepare for his coming to event. Let us prepare our hearts to receive the Prince of Peace as we share the peace of Jesus among with signs of love and greetings of grace. Greet one another.
Let us pray together. Christ, our Advent, hope, and love, remind us to prepare for your coming. Remind us to prepare for this time when the soles of your feet touch the ground, when you will become one of us to be one with us. May we watch for the signs, listen for the messages, wait for the good news to slip into our world, our lives.
Christ, our Advent, hope, and love, let us clear to the way for you, to clear the clutter from our minds, to sift the silt from our hearts, to move the boulders that prevents us
meeting you. May sorrow take flight, and your people sing a song of peace, and hope and love be born again in our hearts. Amen.
The offering you gave last week allowed ministry to happen within our church and in response to the needs of our community. It also helped support the work of ministries beyond our local church that has reaches people who are in desperate need to hear the good news of love, that this season has a special reason. The reason we celebrate this season is because of Jesus. As the ushers come forward, please pray with me. Generous God, we thank you for bringing us to this season of faith, hope, and love. As we took our lives, we see proof of many ways that you have provided for our needs. Let our hearts overflow and with thankfulness and kindness as we joyfully share what you have given. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
congregation this morning is number 206 in your hymnals, I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light. Let's remain standing as we sing.
Gospels is Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judah, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all of Judah were going out to him, and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when they saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come, bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourself, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire, his winnowing fork in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. May God bless the reading and hearing of these words. Thanks be to God. Please be seated.
Wow, lots of thank yous to go around before I get started preaching. Thank you, Candy Hooper. Thank you, Linda Weiss. Thank you, Andy. Thank you, Chancel Choir. Thank you, Amelia Power, who is the assistant here. And thank you, Flame Worship Arts. You always do a great job. So proud of you. Way to go. You're awesome. Yeah. I'm one of those people who had a dramatic conversion experience to Christianity. Shortly after that happened, I knew that being saved and choosing to follow Christ had something to do with being in church. So I started going to church and got involved there. Got surrounded by a group of similarly aged Christian brothers who guided me and who are still among my closest friends today. I really thank God for them. After a little while, I became a youth group sponsor. I never had the youth group experience as a kid when you're supposed to, but it came late, and I did get to have a youth group experience when I became a volunteer sponsor. So I would go with the youth group to church camp and events and gatherings and happenings. There was a thing I noticed when I would go to church camp and these sort of revivals or whatever they were for youth. I noticed that the speakers and the preachers that they had invited to these things often had a story something like mine. They had messed up, maybe in some cases done some prison time. I did not, but some of them had been in trouble with the law, that sort of thing. There were people who, like me, had made a lot of mistakes. And after a while of hearing these, and there were several in a row at one point, I got the impression that it was as if we were saying that unless you have some dramatic, narrow escape type story, that you didn't really have anything of value to say to youth. And I don't think that's right. I don't believe that. I'm happy for those of us who were rescued by God's grace, despite our years of sin and rebellion. But there's a better way to become a Christian. It's what we work for in the church. Learn the easy way, not the hard way. Grow up here, get baptized here. You Flame Worship Arts people. In just a few years, you'll have an opportunity to learn about our faith, to understand what it means to follow Jesus, to go through confirmation. That's what we want. We don't need for adults to have a period where they drift away and reject the church or rebel about God. That's one way, as long as you come back, but it's better to stay involved, not drift away. That's a better story, and usually indicative of an overall happier life. But my story is the one that happened to me, so it's the one I got. My first church job, after this conversion and then starting to hang around the church and liking the difference between my old life and my new life, my first church job was as the lawn man. I got to mow the lawn at the church, do the weed eating. And I liked it. I had another full-time job, but somehow it just did my heart good to do something for God in the church. After a while, I got offered a job as assistant youth minister. And I liked that too. And then my boss, the guy that was really just a little bit over, a few months older than me, got married, moved off. So they moved me up to youth minister or director of youth ministries. And as I worked in the church more, I began to feel a calling in my heart to serve God somehow through the church. Now, one of the things that I ought to say at this point is that we United Methodists, along with others, have an understanding, and it's a pretty important one, and it is of the general ministry of all Christians. That's what it says in our doctrine book, our United Methodist Book of Discipline. And what it means is this: you have a ministry too. Sometimes we think, oh, ministry, that's Andy or Linda or Candy or Kevin or Val. You have a ministry too. We're all called to serve God some way in the secular world, as a parent, as a citizen, that sort of thing. Not everybody is called to work in the church, but I began to feel this calling to work in the church. So I talked to my pastor and I said, I think I may be called to be a preacher or at least do something in the church. Got me involved. He got me enrolled in the process to become a candidate for the ordained ministry in the United Methodist Church. And before you know it, about 18 months later, I was appointed pastor of a little church in Paola, Oklahoma. Town of 550. If you go to up I-35 toward Norman or Oklahoma City, you'll see the sign, Paola, Oklahoma. Averaged about 25, 30 people a Sunday. Now that was between, because of my experience, I ended up with three semesters of college with zero credit hours. Okay? Which is not easy to do, by the way. All right? So I was kind of behind academically, and I was appointed to this church in between my sophomore and junior years in terms of my actual standing. And, I served as best I knew how for 2 years at that little church while I finished up. By the way, I graduated on the honor roll, so I picked it up a little bit, all right? But I was there for only 2 years. That little church was used to that, you know. Lots of young ministers coming through. After me, there were a couple that actually commuted. They went to the same school that I did, Perkins School of Theology, on the campus of Southern Methodist University here in Dallas. So they would be there Monday through Thursday doing their schoolwork, and then they'd do their pastoring, visiting, and preaching on the weekends, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Well, Georgia and I had the opportunity to actually move to Dallas. I got a job down in Dallas, so that made it a lot easier, and I was so excited about going to seminary. The people in that little Oklahoma church were nice to us. They must have been forgiving. I felt like I ought to write them a note and say, I'm sorry. You know, I did my best. Thanks for forgiving me. Congratulations on surviving me, you know, that sort of thing. But when we got ready to leave, it was scary and sad. We'd made friendships there. This was a new thing. It was also exciting because of what lay ahead. Got a lot of good advice upon leaving. There was one gentleman who I really admired. He was a faithful supporter of the church, always there, giver. He was involved. And upon my departure, that last Sunday, when I was scheduled to leave that afternoon or either that afternoon or the next morning, head down to Dallas, he gave me these words of advice. He said, don't let them change you at that seminary. I'm guessing I said to him something like, okay. But in my mind, I know what I was thinking. Wait, that's the point. I've got so much to learn. There are things in my own life and my marriage and my own discipleship that I'm hoping will be changed or at least given a fresh start in this new location. And I know what he was saying. So maybe if we had it to do over again, I might have said to him, you may approve of how I am and what I currently believe and how I've been preaching to you, but I want to get better. Which brings us to the Bible reading that we heard read to us a moment ago by Henley Andrews. You know, he shows up every year about this time, second Sunday of Advent. There he is. He's in the readings every year. Old John the Baptist down there at the Jordan River, baptizing people with what we are told is a baptism of repentance. They're confessing their sins out loud. And while all this is going on, John says to them, "This ain't nothing. You wait until the one that is to come shows up. Then you'll see. You can't even compare what I'm doing to what he will do." You know, some people are surprised when they come to church this time of year to have a reading for the sermon from the adult life of Jesus. Seems like maybe the Old Testament prophecies or Mary turning up pregnant, something like that, would be a little more appropriate for these Sundays of Advent. But our mothers and fathers in the faith for a long, long time have said, "Oh no, second Sunday of Advent, this is the right reading. This is the one you need to read." And I think they're right. When Matthew recalled who John was, what he said, how he fit into Jesus' ministry, Matthew, the Jew, who had been schooled in the scriptures, as Jesus was, and the other first disciples had, he was reminded of the words of the prophet Isaiah. He wasn't reminded of the words of the prophet Isaiah. He saw John as the fulfillment of the words of the prophet Isaiah. A voice crying in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord. Make his paths straight." And here's what that means in 21st century Texas speak. These words mean, heads up! He's coming through. Clear the way so he can get through to you. John preached a baptism of repentance. Wow, one of the great, all-time great words of Scripture. Very important concept. Also one that, in my opinion, is very incompletely understood. Told you a little bit about my conversion. I should probably tell you about some of the events that leading up to that moment when I finally got it. My life had not been going in a good direction for a good long while, and I had these friends and relatives that, despite what I was up to and how unlikely a candidate I seemed, would invite me to these preaching revivals, and they'd take me to this stadium thing where this preacher was. They could see that I was not doing well, and they wanted me to experience salvation. And I went to these. And at a couple of them, when they gave the altar call, I went down front. And I knelt, and I prayed. But I made the mistake that many people make in our understanding of repentance. I thought that repentance meant being sorry for your sins, and that's part of it. I thought it was crying tears. I thought it was maybe saying out loud the bad stuff that I'd been up to, the way that people did when they went out to see John. And that is part of it, but it's incomplete. That experience, that recognition, is then supposed to lead us somewhere. It's supposed to have an effect. That's not the end. Crying the tears and saying the words and maybe even apologizing to the other people is not the end. It's kind of the beginning. Repentance is supposed to, that recognition, that experience of seeing that we're on the wrong path is supposed to then do something to us, put us on a new path, change our minds, change our thinking. The word that comes to us in the English as repentance is the word metanoia. You can see the similarities between that word and metamorphosis, transformation, that a caterpillar to a butterfly experiences. Metanoia means and implies several things. One is a change in direction. I'm headed this direction. I'm choosing my own course. I'm deciding my own thing. I'm headed in this direction of sin or rebellion or whatever, or even just self-centeredness. And to experience metanoia means you turn around and you face a new direction. But it's even deeper than that. I think the best understanding of repentance and metanoia is this: to think differently afterwards. To think differently afterwards. So John's down there by the river and he's preaching. And while he's at it, encouraging the people who are confessing and making a change to their lives and experiencing repentance, he has some pretty harsh words to say to some onlookers, some who came down to listen to him preach, watch him baptize, but he scolds them pretty bad because he knew they didn't want to think different. They'd pretty much already made up their minds. They were curious, but already dead set against changing course. Now, interestingly, Jesus would follow John's example in the sense that the harshest words spoken during Jesus' earthly ministry were to those same kind of people who heard his teachings but wouldn't listen to what he was saying. Who heard his words but wouldn't let his teachings touch them, who were exclusive and judgmental, and maybe worst of all, convinced they were already as good as they needed to be. Convinced they were already pretty much completely right. Absolutely convinced. I don't really need to change. Can you imagine being this far away from the Lord Jesus himself, but not being willing to clear the way for him to actually get through to their lives and their attitudes? Advent, all this blue and hope and joy and love and peace. It's about the coming of Jesus. But we say some weird things during Advent. Have you noticed in those prayers? You might take the order of worship home and actually look at what it is we invite you to pray about. Because we talk about the coming of Jesus not just as a historical event, which did happen, thank God, but as a promise. We also talk about Jesus coming again. And if you understand it right, then you understand that when we talk about Jesus coming again, it's not just at the end of time. It's Jesus' promise, ability, and even faithfulness to come again today to anyone that's willing to clear the way and let him through. When do we need to clear the way and let him through? All the time. It's hard to live that way. Especially at HEB and Walmart and parking lot and things like that, you know. Sometimes it's hard to think like a Christian. But there's, but we need it all the time. Can you imagine this? Imagine something I think is probably common to many persons, at least once or twice in their lives. Imagine a household scene and some people aren't getting along. Could be spouses, could be relatives, could be a kid and their parents. Maybe they're engaged in a shouting match and things are not going well. Can you imagine if one of them was to say words like this, "I don't think what we're doing is making God happy. How about we each go to our rooms and just pray about this and then come back together? Now, if the parent says it to the kid, then the kid might say back, you're just saying that because the preacher said it in the sermon yesterday, all right? To which I would respond, so? So? Getting some good advice and following it? Getting some words that might be good for us and saying them? Being exposed to a new teaching and saying, how about let's try it? That's one of the finest examples a parent can set for their children. I found something better. Let's try it. If that were to happen, you know what I think would be going on? I think it would be people clearing the way so that Jesus can get through. And he will show up. If you can't sense his guidance in your head or heart, and sometimes that happens because we're so emotional, we're so angry, we're so upset, sometimes you can't really hear from God. It's okay. His words are in the Bible. You can always go there. You can find out what he had to say there. He'll show up. And then, what if we cleared the way and came to think differently afterwards? You know what we would call that? We would call that a gift from God. We would call that repentance. Now, as I'm preaching this part of the sermon, let me acknowledge, even for me, this is where some of this tends to get personal, all right? Friends, don't get so paranoid. Don't think that you're so bad. Don't feel so guilty that you're not open to change. We get defensive, you know? Because the truth of the matter is that every one of us have at least one or two or 100 areas in our lives where we've sort of made up our mind, I don't want to change on this. If I start listening to other people's opinion on this, if I stop trying to control that other person, where's that going to lead? If I actually let Jesus into my workplace, into my thinking, to my finances, to my marriage, I mean, what's going to happen then? Being closed off like that tends to trap us. Jesus said, you'll know the truth. And the truth will set you free. So I noticed, you know what? I am stuck on this. I'm afraid to consider that other opinion. That's the truth. You shall know the truth. And the truth shall set you free. I read about a woman whose husband died. They had enjoyed several years after retirement together. They lived out in the country on a plot of land that they had loved and nurtured and walked together. In the months following his death, she grew sadder and more withdrawn. She couldn't keep up with the needs of that property, couldn't even bring herself to do housework. I mean, the place was looking bad. It was cluttered. They had one son who had a wife and two boys. He would come to visit her. He tried to cheer her up. He'd help as he could. She acknowledged, I love this place and I love it still, but I don't even want to look outside because the way things are growing up, I just can't keep up with it. Son said, how about if I bring the family down? The boys are old enough to do a little work. We'll come down and help you pick up things. We'll clean up the outside. We'll clean up the inside. Would that be okay? Reluctantly, she said, okay. So, family came down. All had their work clothes in. They raked and mowed and even trimmed some tree branches, picked up all sorts of stuff. As they were finishing up, the woman who remained inside went to her window And as she looked out, she gasped in surprise at what she saw. Her son had taken a chainsaw to an old overgrown tree, didn't cut it down, but simply cleared out the many intertwined branches, the overgrowth in that tree. And for the first time in years, she could actually see through the tree from her kitchen window to what lay beyond. Rolling hills, even a view of a lake in the distance. And she remembered, that view is one of the reasons we bought this place. That view is why we built our house this way, with this window here. She hurriedly walked outside, approached her son, who was still up in the tree with the chainsaw on. He saw her approach and turned off the saw. She called out to him, "Thank you, thank you. I can see, and it's beautiful." And friends, that's the way it can be. When we do the clearing needed to let Jesus through, allowing him and his vision for living to get through to us, we'll see an invitation to follow a path that is truly beautiful. And the difference between his way and the way that we so often walk can be called repentance. But it's so significant that it's also called salvation. Heads up. He's coming through. Let's each of us clear the way. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Tolley. Well, as we turn our hearts to the sacrament of Holy Communion, let's sing a hymn together. This is What Feast of Love. We'll remain seated as we sing.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us in silence each confess our sins before God. Amen. Hear the good news. Not because we are deserving, but because of God's grace, great mercy. In the name of Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus sat at table with his disciples. He took bread, and when he had given thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to God and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." When we share this meal together, we celebrate the very promised presence of Christ among us and remember that he has promised to come again. Thanks be to God. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us join together in the prayer that our Lord has taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." There are two instructions I'd like to share with you because of the Advent decorations and the garland on our communion rail. First of all, we do encourage you, you're welcome to come and kneel at the altar rail. However, we will not be serving you there because of the limited space for the elements. We'll have two stations here. Please come by right here in the middle because of the busyness and the decorations. We will be receiving our communion rail offering in this basket. If you're prepared and wish to give, this month's communion rail offering will go to offset some of the costs of our upcoming free community Christmas dinner. We expect it'll be an even bigger crowd this year, but every year we serve about 500 people, all sorts of people from all over town, and your gifts will help with that effort. It is our Lord himself who invites us. So with joy, let us come to the table of our Lord. Thank you.
Let us give thanks to God as we pray together. Lord, you have shown us your love in the heavens of your heavenly. As we leave your table, usher us in your kingdom now forever. Amen.
Our hymn of invitation this morning is number 202 in your hymnals, People Look East. We're going to sing verses 1 and 2. Let's stand and sing. People look east, the time is near. Of the crowning of the year, make your house fair as you are able. Trim the hearth and set the table. People look east and sing today. Love the guest, he's on the way. Furrows be glad, the earth is bare. One more seed is planted there. Give up your strength, the seed to nourish, that in course the flower may flourish. People look east and sing today. Love the roses on the way.
As we leave this place, what is our mission?
To make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. A couple of announcements to share with you briefly. First of all, please keep up with the many opportunities that are offered this time of year, not only for service and involvement, but just enjoying and celebrating all that Christmas means. Take a look at the back of your bulletin. Let me draw your attention to one event in particular. Next Sunday, our children will be presenting their Christmas play, and I just think everybody who's able ought to be a part of some children's Christmas something every year, and this is an opportunity for you to be a part of and help support our kids, so come and be a part of it. 5 p.m. next Sunday in Fidelis Hall. Those of you that are interested in being a part of being one of the many working parts that are needed for our Christmas Day free community lunch, are invited following this service to join a planning meeting that's happening in the conference room, which is toward the church office. We need lots of people. If you just want to find out what's going on, and those of you that are already part of that work team are encouraged to be a part of that. I think that's about all I have to say. Oh, no, there's one other thing. I know that apparently there were some letters that went out to people who had already returned their estimate of giving cards and said, you haven't turned in your estimate of giving card. I'm sorry, I don't know how it happened. You know, somebody messed up. Please forgive us. Unless you want to give another estimate of giving card, double it up or something like that. Please forgive us, we'll get it straightened out in the days that are ahead. Now, as we go forth, receive this benediction. Hey, go clear the way this day and in the days ahead so that Jesus can get through to you and me and others through us and to the world. Go in peace. Amen.